Hi, I'm Tyler Bletsch with the Electrical and Computer Engineering Department here at Duke, and I want to answer the question, what is a computer really? So you have lots of computers in your life. You might have a laptop computer or a desktop computer, but there's also lots of weird computers you might not realize. Your phone is a computer. There's a computer in your car that controls the pistons firing in the engine. So what is a computer really? A computer is a machine that's going to take inputs from a human or from a sensor or from another computer and process them, do a series of logical prescribed steps to them in order to produce output, information that can be then given back to a human, to a machine of some kind, or to another computer. We want to understand what a computer is really, though, so let's take one apart now. So here we have a small desktop computer, and we're just going to pop this thing open and see what the bits are. And the interesting thing is, a computer, when you look at the box, 99% of it does not do the computing. So we're going to get a lot of extra stuff out of the way before we get to the actual parts that do the computing. We'll pop the cover off here. So the first thing we see on top here is this hard disk drive. This is a spinning platter of iron that's used to permanently store your files, documents, programs, things like that. But this is not actually doing the computing, so let's pop it out of here. In this computer, the whole thing just slides out, and we can see the main board of the computer. Now, this doesn't actually do the computing. It's a bunch of copper that connects little components together. These components include the ports on the front and back that can connect to inputs and outputs, things like microphones, speakers, keyboards, and so on. We also see the random access memory plugged in here. This is the RAM. Random access memory is temporary storage, where the computer notes the documents and programs that you're currently running right now. The other two main things on the main board are the I/O controller and the CPU. The I/O controller stands for Input-Output Controller. It's a chip that governs all of these ports, so it doesn't actually do the computing either. All the computing happens under here, with the CPU, the Central Processing Unit. The metal here is called a heat sink. CPUs generate heat when they function, and this metal will gather and dissipate that heat. Let's take a look at what's underneath this. So here we have the CPU, and even this, most of this is not the actual CPU. All the green stuff here is just connections to run out to these pins that then interface with the main board. The actual CPU is underneath that little metal can there. Under there is a tiny wafer of silicon that actually is the CPU, that does the computing. It consists of billions of transistors that have been laid out by a person in order to form the logic of the CPU that allows it to run software and do the things we want our computers to do. So if a CPU has billions of transistors and they're designed by people, how is that possible? How can a person design something with a billion parts? Well, here's what you don't do. You don't sit down and say, well, I'll put the first one here and the second one this way, and by the year 9000, we'll be ready. That's not how you design a CPU. To do this, we have to learn a fundamental concept from engineering, abstraction. Abstraction is the key to designing the large and complex systems you see around, not just CPUs, but everything. Abstraction is the idea that we can solve one small, simple problem. Our solution might have some complexity, but we can do it. We then drop a black box over that and say, this is the solution to this problem. We can then take that black box and use it multiple times in a larger, more complex solution. We can then drop a black box over that and use that to solve yet more complex problems until by the end of it, we've built an entire CPU where a person can understand any one step or part of the design, but the entire design has billions of pieces. To understand this idea of abstraction, let's use it right now, and we're going to design part of the CPU. We're going to design the part that allows us to add numbers. Now, before we can do this, we have to understand a fundamental concept, digital logic. So we build digital logic using transistors, small electric switches. We can use these switches to create logic gates, so we can answer true-false questions. For example, this is an AND gate. An AND gate can tell us when both of its inputs are true. Here we see 0 and 0, that is false and false. The result is false. If it's 0 and 1, still false. 1 and 0, still false. Because it's AND, we need the A input and the B input to be true. When they're both turned on, the output is 1. So AND gates tell us when both inputs are true. This is an OR gate. It tells us when at least one input is true. So here, 0 or 0, we get a 0. But in the case of 0 or 1, output is true. 1 or 0, output is true. And of course, 1 or 1, output is still true. The last gate we'll be needing is called an exclusive OR gate. An exclusive OR gate tells us when exactly one input is true. So here, with 0 exclusive OR 0, the output is 0. 0 exclusive OR 1, the output is true. 1 exclusive OR 0, the output is true. But unlike the OR gate here, with 1 exclusive OR 1, the output is 0. We'll use these three gates to build the basis of mathematics. So to summarize, here we see all three kinds of gates with their corresponding truth tables, tables that tell us what their output is for any given input. So now we have these logic gates. We can compute true-false answers, and now we need to find our way to making numbers out of these. The easiest way computer engineers know how to do this is binary, or base 2. The number system you're used to is base 10, or decimal. So in base 10, or decimal, when you write a 1, it just means a 1, normal. When you write a 10, that means 10. That's why it's base 10. When you write 100, that means 10 times 10, or 100. When you write 1000, it means 10 times 10 times 10, or 1000. Now what happens if we take all these 10s and turn them into 2s? That's how you get binary. In binary, 1, still a 1. 10 now means 2. 100 means 2 times 2, or 4. 1000 means 2 times 2 times 2, or 8. And so on. These binary digits are called bits. Binary digit, bit. A bit can be a 0 or a 1. So now that we know that, let's do some basic math, and we'll come back to decimal for a minute. We're going to compute 1 plus 1. We do it just like we did in school. 1 plus 1 is 2. Very good. Now let's do a binary. Same setup, 1 plus 1, and the answer is, in binary, 10. Which is how binary says 2. So can we build a logic circuit whose behavior does binary addition? Yes. The answer is a half-adder circuit shown here. The half-adder uses two of the logic gates we've learned, and an exclusive OR, to compute the lower place digit and the higher place digit of the answer. Here we have our inputs A and B going into the AND gate, and an exclusive OR gate. We can see that if it's 0 plus 0, the answer is 0, 0. If it is 0 plus 1, the answer is 0, 1. If it's 1 plus 0, the answer is still 0, 1. And if it's 1 plus 1, the answer is 1, 0, or our representation of 2. Now, what if we want to add numbers larger than 1? That seems like a thing we probably want. For that, we have to think back to how we learned to do arithmetic back in school. You might remember doing carrying when you add. So let's add some decimal numbers. If we want to add 8 plus 15, we'll start by adding the 8 and the 5. That gives us 13. We put the 3 down there, and we carry the 1 up there in red. Now we add the carried 1 and the existing 1, and we get the 2, and that drops down. So our answer is 23. Carrying was an essential part of decimal addition. We can do the same thing in binary. So let's take this example. We're going to be adding 3 and 6, but in binary. In binary, 3 is represented as 011, and 6 is represented by 110. So let's do the addition. The 1 plus the 0, 1. No carry. In the next column, we have 1 plus 1. That's 2, or as we know it, 10. So we put a 0 down there, and we carry the 1. So now we have the carried 1, a 0, and another 1. So it's 1 plus 0 plus 1. We get, again, 10. The 0 goes down, and we carry the 1 once more. Drop that down, and we got our answer, 1001, which in decimal is 9. So 3 plus 6 is 9. So now that we have digital logic and this concept of binary addition with carrying, can we build a circuit to implement this carrying using digital logic? We can, and it's called the full adder, shown here. It has 3 inputs and 2 outputs. The inputs are A and B, like before, and an additional carry in that tells us what the carry is from the previous stage of addition. It has 2 outputs, the lower sum bit and the upper carry out bit. It tells us if there is a carry going to the next stage of addition. We can run through some scenarios with this circuit. Obviously, if it's 0 plus 0 plus 0, the answer is 0, 0. If it's 0 plus 1 plus 0, the answer is 0, 1. If we do 1 plus 1, we still get 1, 0. But now we can say, what if it is 0 plus 1 with a carry of 1, or 0 plus 1 plus 1? Now the answer is 1, 0. And we can go further and say, what if it's 1 plus 1 with a carry of 1? We get the answer 1, 1. Now, there's a lot of logic gates in here and complexity that we don't want to think about as we design our larger adding system. So let's drop a black box over this thing and use abstraction. We'll just call the whole thing full adder, not worry about the details, and just note that it takes 3 inputs and has 2 outputs. So now let's use this full adder in a larger design. We're going to stamp 3 of them together and chain them, carry out to carry in. This allows us to build what's called a ripple carry adder. This example is a 3-bit ripple carry adder, and we can use it to do the same math as before, 3 plus 6. We'll input into the A inputs the bits 0, 1, 1, or 3. We'll put into the B inputs 1, 1, 0, the number 6. You can see how it chains together, and we get our correct answer, 1, 0, 0, 1, or 9. So using purely digital logic and the concept of abstraction, we've built a system that can add arbitrary numbers. So how do we build the rest of the CPU? The answer is still abstraction. We keep finding small problems we know how to solve directly, putting solutions together, abstracting those, combining those pieces together to form larger and larger solutions to problems, until finally we've built the entire CPU. Abstraction is an extremely powerful concept that's fundamental to human problem solving, and it's something you can apply in your everyday life.